please hold on to the end.
I'll also be available for a chat if we don't get to it.
Why?
So I've been doing software dev for over 10 years now, and the last 7 of which have been at ThoughtWorks. I'm the market tech principal for ThoughtWorks here at Perth. And if you see me on the client side, usually I'll be a tech lead or I'll be providing technical advice. Because I'm a consultant, I've had the pleasure and misfortune sometimes of seeing a whole bunch of different workplaces and a whole bunch of different things that work within one. Between places that I've actually worked at as an employee and clients, I've seen over 25 different places and all the different incarnations of stuff. So why are we here? So I'd like to start this with a story. So late last year, I was actually working on a paid side project that was called Vision, and I was delivering in my spare time outside of my day job more value than some teams that I've been on. This includes teams where I was on. This isn't the first time I've had a similar experience. It was really frustrating. I know I'm not the best developer in the world, but I wanted to understand why this was happening. So I started trying to write down all the things that I could think of. I started thinking of all the things that I found really frustrating at work, and very quickly became this guy. And for this talk, I really tried to unpack that and not be that guy. Don't get me wrong, this at some level is going to be a group therapy session for me. So this talk is not about operating models, budgeting, or any of those higher order problems, which are legitimate problems. This is not about winning this, MVPs, build measure learn. Like, I don't really have the credibility to talk about that in any depth. They're definitely problems, but they're also in their own right. The concepts that we're going to talk about today, though, are totally complementary to the solutions you'll find in that space. This talk is about me trying to empathize with why companies build software the way they currently do. It's about why they behave the way they do, highlighting some of those problems, and thinking about if there are approaches that we can adopt to make some of those problems go away. And it's also about giving you, as some ammunition to have some of the harder conversations about bigger changes that are really required to fix some of these problems. If you also bear with me, this talk comes at the problem from a bunch of different perspectives, because I really wanted to give a broader overview of how we tackle this stuff. I'm not going to go into full detail for all of these things, but feel free to come speak to me at the end or ask questions. It's also a little bit of a bull's arms. To be a bit cliche, 2017, and software is literally eating the world. Many organizations are being dragged kicking and screaming to become technology companies, whether they really like it or not. If I was an enterprise, I'd be wanting to use my size and market position make it really hard for people to unseat me. If I was a disruptor, I'd be using my size to run rings around the incumbent. And we're starting to see that play out now. Currently, the way things are, I'm betting on the disruptors having the edge, because I see for a lot of enterprises, they need to really flip the table on how they're going to do stuff. So what can they do? There's big problems. Well, the first thing they can do is you start making the most of the people that they have now. This is one of my favorite quotes from Adrian Kochroff when he was in Netflix. He just gave a presentation and was recalling a collective of complaints to a bunch of CIOs and CTOs that had just attended his talk. The first part was him paraphrasing them. But we don't have all these amazing Netflix superstar engineers. The second part was his response. After looking around the room, he said, well, we just hide them from you and then go down and go away. Sadly, over the time I've been working, I've definitely heard the first part a couple of times. But unfortunately, I'm yet to hear the second part. So, currently, the way I see most organizations, they were established in the times of management theory class. People are resources. Things are not going well. Ignoring the fact that if the man not existing for a while, they just throw more people out. You can just shuffle people around between teams, and that's fine. They'll perform exactly the way they did. And we can save money by standardizing everything. As a result, I look around and I see a bunch of disempowered people and really frustrated teams. And I also see that playing out on the flip side of these companies finding it really hard to recruit people because they're working with a small pool of people. to hunt. So what can the direct about this? Well, you empower them. So this slide, I was thinking about it, you pretty much be summarized as, for those who haven't, go read Dan King's book, Drive. If you have already read it, go reread it. I was trying to articulate exactly in this space what I'm seeing work. And then I just reread the book and it was like a light bulb going off for me. Autonomy is around desire to direct our own lives. Feel like we're in control of what we're actually doing. Mastery is the urge to make progress and get better at something that matters. So for a lot of developers, like, developing is not engineering. Developing is art. It's a creative endeavor. And it's something that we like to get better and better at. And purpose. Purpose is the yearning to do what we're doing in the service of something bigger than ourselves. This is really believing in what the company is doing. And that's why in a lot of startups, they're living and breathing this stuff, which is why they're motivated. We need to trust that people do the right thing. For the most part, they probably will. Many companies in this space try to raise for extrinsic motivation. So they throw money at people. From my experience, that will buy companies some time. But also from my experience, that won't keep people there. Intrinsic motivation, on the other hand, is about actually making people love and feel empowered in their job. And that can be a massive, massive multiplier to productivity. The problem with autonomy is when it's not paired with accountability. So far too often I see people making decisions that are based on dogma or architectural purity. I've heard, sadly, multiple times now, a bunch of horror stories about where people have spent 18 months doing something with zero realized value. They've never released anything to actually end users. I don't care, within reason, of course, what you do, but you have to deliver. You have to be able to justify your decisions, and you have to live with money. Alright, so now we've got motivated people. How do we get the best out of them? Well, we need to address the way that many organizations expect their resources to work the same way. So here we work 8:30 a.m. You must wear business attire. You must do all of your work from the assigned workstation. These are all things that I've heard. Not everyone's productive at the same time. I know if you plot the way I work, I'm peaky. We need to make contribution better and easier outside of office hours. And better yet, see if we can make it work outside of the office. We need to embrace the type of autonomy and empower people to make decisions around when they work rather than how long they work. Another thing that I see happen is this big push to collaborative workspaces. Collaborative workspaces and pairing are really awesome tools because they allow for great cross-pollination of ideas. The problem is some people really don't work well in environments and there's sort of no concessions made to that. I've got friends that were quite happy just working in a cafe. We need to enable people to work in spaces that suit their personality or even their mood. And then we need to take it up a level. So teams in many organizations are aligned with numerous people outside of their actual own circle to get anything done. We need to speed that process up by making teams autonomous as well. We need to make sure they have empowered, decisive being the key word there, product owners setting direction. We need to make sure they have all the members and resources required to get their stuff done in the self-service way. They need to be able to access infrastructure in a self-service way. And it should be guiding principles for how to do things. Security is a great example of this. So they can make decisions within the team aligning to the principles without having to go outside for permission. In addition, we need to make sure that all of the different roles required to actually get stuff done are present. It doesn't necessarily have to be a one-to-one mapping, but we need to have someone that's taking ownership of it. Each of the roles needs to have a champion. And we can spread this out by making things responsible to the whole team. QA is a great example of this. It's awesome when you have a QA on the team, but quality is the responsibility of the entire team. This is an entire talk in itself. There's many talks around high-performance teams. People like Pat Barr, Dan North, do a really good job of that. And you should go look that stuff up if you're interested in this. The next problem I see is that many organizations, when they have a well-performing team, the next thing they do is split it up. Sometimes it's because the project ends, because we're working on project last cycles. But it's also because they're trying to do something more well-intentioned. This team is awesome. Let's spread them out and make all the other teams also have good strategy. The problem is that humans don't really work this way. Many of you will see Bruce Tuckman's model for group development. So this is storming, norming, forming, performing. These are stages that all teams go through, and it's only really towards those later stages that as a team you're actually really productive. The problem is, when you add a new person to a team, that's a brand new team. And the cycle begins anew. You do this a few times, and you just really frustrate people. And like I've seen this play out, they just get really motivated to just leave. Ideally, like the way I've seen this like solved for real, is to actually align around products. The problem is in many of the organizations we're talking about, that actually requires fundamental organizational change to happen. In a conventional organization, what I've seen sort of play out is you can fake that a little bit. So you can make the team sticky, keep them together, and just change the work. So you move the team from project to project, not stand up a brand new team every time. So in a nutshell, give people the space to do their jobs. When something is working, try to understand why. But don't, you know, try and split them up. Replicate those concepts while keeping the teams together delivering done, because they're already doing good stuff. So, all right, let's get security now. So, another thing we'll see is, it's pretty familiar proxy message. This happened at a client. I was trying to look at the documentation for Drop Wizard. Drop Wizard's pretty cool, but I think Pornhub is probably a bit of a stretch. So currently, the way I see it with security is there's an adversary relationship with security in most places. It's kind of understandable given they're the ones responsible for keeping things secure. Generally, they're outnumbered by the rest of delivery, in most cases by a lot. And as developers, we do stupid shit all the time. In practice, the way it usually plays out is you talk to security, they take ages to respond because they're small. They give you a massive incomprehensible list of rules to follow for those years. Some point in time they go to say no, and then you fill out a great amount of paperwork. In a lot of places, we don't fix this. We just do this dance every single time and we don't release anything meaningful. So how do we fix that? Well, the first thing I fix is the incentives. So security is incentivized to prevent security issues, not deliver value. Delivery is incentivized to deliver value, being security to the security people. Solving this problem and solving it properly will really require a restructure. So how do we make it better given the current setting? Well, we need to acknowledge first off that they can't do it all, and we need the delivery teams to pick up the slack. Kind of like that QA example, actually care about security. This is classic system thinking, right? So we optimize the overall solution rather than the subsystem. So we don't try to make security better, we try to make the whole organization care about security. The easiest way that I've seen to do this without a restructure is just to involve them and as early as possible. As Jez Humble would say, take them out for lunch and understand their problems. Involve them in inceptions. Get them embedded in your team for a period of time if you can. Come up with them a security checklist you can apply to all your stories. We can take this a step further though and actually amplify what they're wanting to do by codifying that into what you're actually doing. So this sort of takes two levels. We can do this at the infrastructure level and the application level. From the infrastructure level, you can use a platform that makes security simple. I tend to gravitate towards Heroku. It has many things already baked into it, which makes some of the effort I go into security something I don't really have to care about. A lot of organizations, that's not going to apply. So if we are building a platform for running this stuff, let's build security into it to get a similar experience. Let's make things like SSL simple. Let's automate things like rate limiting and intrusion protection. Let's make monitoring and logging really simple. At the application level, we need to work out a way that we can scale all of the learnings and all the things they want us to do. So the way I've seen work really well is creating playbooks for automating best practices, so baking some of that stuff into the way you do code. About putting simple tooling into review dependencies, check to see whether you've checked any credentials, static code analysis. You can work with your friendly security person hopefully on the team, and come up with a good balance of what security versus delivery looks like. So now our friends with security, we can start having some more open conversations with them. So I don't know, I sort of get this because I get to see more multiple places, but have you seen what developers do when you put restrictions like proxies in their way? They're not like regular users. It's great security the whole thing. Authenticated proxies are a massive time suck. And I feel kind of they feel like a lack of trust under the guise of security. I get that like they need the proxies sometimes, networks can be complicated, but now I have my credentials that are in plain text for all these apps that I use. Is that better? Obviously not. what I've seen work really well is when organizations that do have this need go down the rise of transparent proxy. You almost have to weigh down backwards, but you shouldn't need me to actually force myself to my credentials all the time. Once we've sorted out getting access to the internet, we need to get people proper control over their machines. So they're going to need to run VMs or containers, it's 2017, to make it so they can. They'll lock down the files, which is good. We need to make sure they have local mapping on their machines from the start. This isn't a thing that happens in software companies. It just seems to be enterprises trying to apply the same rules that they apply to all their other users. We have this fight every time we go into a new client, and in the end, it always comes out that who's going to do that. If possible, give people just real physical machines. If you really must go down the route of putting things in VMs, they need to really perform because you will kill people's flow unless you can actually do things at the speed that they need to be doing things at. The only way I've seen these problems be resolved is actually coming down to a recent discussion around most of the time. So usually it involves the business, which is starting to really like you as well, which is going to be delivering value, and also our new security friends. So let's have some honest conversations. There are still some organizations that refuse to use the cloud, ignoring all its advantages. So quite often this is from a fear of lack of control on your behalf. And sometimes because it's their existing skills. The existing staff don't have those skills and they're trying to protect them. Some hype behind things like, we can't use the cloud because APRA. APRA says something more like, don't use the cloud for systems of record because we don't think you guys can most of your right. Another third fear is, it's secure if it's in our data center. Ignoring the fact that very few organizations actually own their own data center. My favourite one though, what's to stop Amazon selling their code to a competitor? Pretty sure that they're a pretty successful business doing what they do. Again, solving this problem is best done by demonstrating that you can actually use the tools available. You can use infrastructure as code. You can bake security into the way you do things securely and productively. Amazon, Azure, Google, take the lead. They have all the security protocols in the world you need to be able to do things securely. You just need to use them. One thing I would say here though is, because if you get it wrong, and this will totally counter your argument, make sure you don't just get it working. Understand how these things work, because a lot of the guides that you'll see on the internet actually make things inherently insecure. So in a nutshell, make friends with your security team, because you need allies for all of these things. Make security best practices into everything you do, so you don't have to think about them all the time. And try not to settle for no. Change the conversation to why not? Wow. And then start leveraging opinionated productive tech. Or as I like to say, making choices that allow you to focus on delivering value as soon as possible. So I'm going to go to a few companies. So what do they have in common? So Etsy, Slack, Wikipedia, WordPress, Facebook. That would be scared, too. The laugh was because there's a whole bunch of you in the room that wouldn't even consider using PHP. And I've seen that a lot. But, it may be boring, but it's mature. I myself gravitate towards using Rails. It's slow, that's what you hear, right? But it makes me fast. Now, when it comes to bottleneck, I can keep working on that. And very rarely, it's not the actual bottleneck. So what I see in the tech space is I see lots of shiny-driven design. Sometimes I like to refer to this as resume-driven design. People introduce new technologies because they like it, but without necessarily having a plan to how to deal with it going forward. I see a lot of sunk cost fallacy playing out. We spent millions on TIBCO, Oracle, IBM product. Sure, it sucks, but we have to use it because we spent all this money. No, you don't. You really don't. Why throw good money after that if you can do something better faster? So what we need to do is be opinionated and deliberate with our choices. There's a reason a lot of successful companies actually only standardize on a couple of different tech. So we need to work out what works really well for us. The way I've seen work really well for this is to actually create a radar of where we are now, all the things we're using, and where we think we should be going. We need to choose mature, productive tech where appropriate. So the failure modes of these things are really well known. Operationalizing a new platform is really hard. So there's some great bits of advice from people from Etsy or Reddit around choosing boring technology that you can Google. When we're doing this evaluation of what's really working though, we need to make sure that we're being holistic. We need to make sure we're looking for the right qualities. If you can't test it, it's not viable. If it can't be automated, it's not viable. If it's too expensive to run across all of your environments, it might be freaking amazing. Like, maybe it's not. I'm not saying that you can't use new technology, because that's just crazy. What I'm saying is, you just need to spend your innovation focus wisely. Introducing new tech that solves the problem, if you feel that the benefits outweigh the impacts of all the unknowns that you may be running into. I also see a lot of organizations trying to build frameworks. They hypothesize about all the potential use cases and how this will solve all the problems in the world. The problem is, when you try to build something for everyone, you build nothing for anyone. We need to not focus on all the possibilities. We need to focus on problems that we have right now. We need to extract those lessons from building the first one. They could be code. They may not even be reusable. They may just be knowledge. And we need to not be dogmatic. This thing will not solve every problem. And we need to work out what it is good at and what it is not good at. A slight difference to this is common services, because common services are a useful thing to be doing. But we need to make sure that we follow the same principles. We need to be building for known use cases of known consumers, rather than hypothesizing how people are going to use this. Building a path to prod is a trap that I see all the time. Many organizations can build software no problems. The problem is that they'll spend three times as long trying to get into production as they do actually building it in the first place. Many problems that arise in this space, they take a lapse time, not actual working time, so it's best to get them kicked off as soon as possible. By pushing the simplest possible bit of code right away, you can also avoid any complexity that comes from the app itself. You can deal with that as you go along incrementally. As you're finding all these lessons, we need to really capture this stuff as scripts to make sure that when we're moving through new environments, this becomes a trivial thing. It's like, right, what new environment? Well, here you go. And we need to make it easy to do this all the time. So many teams reinvent the wheel every single time they start a new bit of work. Don't force yourself to make decisions every time you start a new project. There's still the lessons learned into something you can use. So I call this playbook, other people call it well played, blueprints, whatever you want. These need to be based on real world use. So they've got the lessons learned of failures. So this is the Netflix paper concept, right? You don't have to use it, but it will solve a lot of the common problems you'll face if you actually bootstrap yourself with this. It's important to remember though, this is not a framework. This is a starting point. Where you can adapt for your own application. If you learn better or new ways of doing things, more failures, bake that into the playbook so you don't run into the same problems next time. So, in a nutshell, we need to consolidate the technology to make sure things are productive. We need to get to prod as soon as possible, and we need to be in a position where we can build as little as possible to solve the actual problems we have. Let's talk about architecture. I apologize for the architects here. So just as a quote from a client architect, you shall remain nameless. Some of us don't have a background in software. Should we really be making technical decisions? No. So what I see in the organization, I'm yet to see an architecture set up that I feel is really conducive to delivering valuable software. In many cases, the architecture team functions as gatekeepers. I've heard things like, we make $1 million decisions, the devs make $1,000. My problem is, often those decisions are made in isolation from the teams that are most affected by them. Often these people aren't on the tools, so they're missing context about what good looks like currently. They do this mostly with good intentions. They genuinely believe that models, standards, and more governance are the path forward. My problem is that I've never seen it play out that way in the entire time I've been working. So, what would be better? So, governance. Love governance. Governance for the sake of governance is kind of like forcing square pegs into round holes. Like, we do have real constraints, right? Personal info, how we handle money, like, those are things where we need to make sure there's plenty of rigor around. The problem is, when governance is constraining beyond the actual problems we have, it just really frustrates teams. It also demotivates the people on the ground because they don't feel like they've got their autonomy anymore. What I've seen better is to collaboratively come up with guiding principles. So, source by facilitating discussions between teams. So, MYOB is a great example of this. They capture that as their platform manifesto. Some other organizations do this via active tech lists. So, they get all the tech leads together across the different products to work out how they're going to stuff. The architecture team are actually well-placed, being central, to look after these principles for the rest of the organization. The other thing they're really well-placed to do is look after the big picture. So this could allow tech leads can also contribute to the big picture by contributing with that library. Some may call this architecture working group, about what they're up to. John Wolfsport, the former CTO of Etsy, has a great blog post about this that you should go look up. His belief is that fundamentally, engineering decision-making is a socially constructed activity. With a high-level view, architects team are actually well-placed to contribute in this conversation because they have that different perspective. If teams want to do something new, they're also a really great way that you can find out where and how things have been done in the organization, so you don't need to read that too well. All right. Let's keep architecture simple. So another big source of problems are overcomplicated or purist architectures. We must use asynchronous things. We must pass up all the things. Microservices as well, right? Their flavor of the month. They have lots of benefits, but people rarely talk about the downsides. In fact, if you talk to someone like Sam Newman, who literally wrote a book on microservices, he'll tell you, don't build microservices. Solve the problems. If microservices are the solution to that problem, that's awesome. It's okay to consciously build a monolith, especially if you don't understand the domain. That's where most of the problems are going to come from. It's simpler to build, debug, deploy. We can still architect within the monolith, split it up later, like good software engineering practices. The difference is it's much easier to refactor within an app than across apps if you've messed up that domain split. And chances are, if we can't get it right here, we're just going to make it 10 times worse by splitting it across the network. The other thing I see is people implementing services which exist because of not invented anyway. If it's not core to your product, don't build it. Leverage existing services rather than building your own solution. I mean, this is how startups get scale, right? Because they build their own product and then use things for doing everything else. Amazon, Google, Azure, bunch of software as a service providers, they're really good at what they're doing. Leverage that fact. You can have your entire app production set up in a day, and those little kind of just work. If you really must want to do it internally, start capturing that as a platform that other teams can essentially recreate the outside world internally. If you do insist on building a platform though, it needs to be competitive with what else is available. It has to be as compelling and well documented as something like Heroku. The best way I've seen to make that happen is actually make Heroku, Google App Engine, Elastic Beanstalk, an option, so long as you satisfy the guiding principle. Ben Barclay, he did, last year, did a talk at EOS a couple of years ago. He's from their platforms team, and he said, we have to make our platform compelling enough to choose, but people don't have to choose it. You need to be in that position if you want to be actually building something which is comparable with all the things out in the real world. In a nutshell, let's use guidance over governance based on collaboratively sourced principles. Let's keep everything simple. Let's look to see if there are existing services we can already use to bootstrap our stuff, both internal and external. Make architecture a communication function, and keep everything simple. That last one was probably the most important. Let's talk about bits of title together. The report is written, and no one reads it. Was it really written? Me, I now read it. I see so much waste in project management, and I don't think I'm alone in finding it frustrating. Massive killer to flow, because basically it just means constant context switching, even if it's not taking up that much of your life's time. The behavior of many large organizations is the product of their past. Many of them predate software. They get around projects, business cases, and funding cycles. There are many problems in that space that require changing the operating model to really solve. Yeah, you've probably seen that's a thing. We still can do better though with what we're currently working with. For me, it comes down to focusing on extracting the most value for investment, regardless of what the structure looks like. Strong product management and strong product owners can hide these things. If you do nothing else in this space, go get yourself a strong, empowered, decisive product owner. It's amazing how many problems can become trivial once you have one. Their decisiveness can mean that you release value much faster by prioritizing that actually the 70% was all that was important. We don't waste the time doing the 30%. They can also unblock the team because they give you a vision and a guideline. If they're not always available, you still have some goalposts and a vision that you're running towards. A I've also found that they can really help change the conversation within the team and focus the team sort of myopically on value. Value produced generally goes up. People stop talking about cost because value is being driven, doesn't really matter. And costs generally actually do the opposite. They tend to go down because they're doing this. What I see in most organizations is focusing on cost. And for me, it's kind of like losing control of a car and ending a tree. When you focus on cost, costs generally go up in the same way that focusing on value tends to do the opposite. I'm sorry, I'm going to rant here. Tools will not fix your process. Communication work. Many organizations, tools are a crutch because, like, in many circumstances, it's easier to buy a tool or buy a solution to fix the actual problem, which is communication. Okay. I hear, we need Jira, or we need a hub one more time. I think I'm not losing. The problem is they don't solve the real problem, which is around communication. In fact, they actually do the opposite. They wrap it within a layer of technology and make it harder to surface the real problems. Let's start from a default position of the simplest tool possible. If you're all co-located, start making the walls. If that doesn't work, go to the next level of fidelity. It may be your team's remote. Maybe try Trello. It's the dumbest thing I can think of that works electronically. As you raise problems, try to work out whether it's actually a problem or it's just different. Sometimes it's okay to raise different. Many organizations require the creation of meaningless reports that are seldom read. And they take away from the core focus of doing value. You only have so many hours in the day and so many great cycles to spend. When you drill into why they're being done that way, though, often the response is, that's just the way we do it. We need to ask why more often. You really have to do X. A lot of the times, people hire consultants like us because we ask the questions. But, letting them know the secret. You can do that too. I don't see that often enough. And I really would like to advocate for all of you to ask why more often. The more you do this, the more of your time will just be spent on getting shit done. And that's probably more important. In a similar thing, we can do the same thing with our agile rituals, right? So I'll give you an example. If you spend 3 days doing an inception, and at the inclusion of that inception, no one knows what we're doing. There's no time for the technical approach. The majority of the team wasn't there to actually, to get that shared understanding. You just wasted 3 days in the inception and you slowed the team down for months. And that doesn't sound like a really good return on investment. Our rituals have an intended purpose, and we need to understand what we're trying to achieve with them. If a ritual is not achieving that intended outcome for you, change it up, work out another way to do it. I've been on teams, for instance, that have moved from going iterations to Kanban because we felt that there was no value in the extra planning of iterations. This is about being agile, not just doing agile or Scrum or insert framework that you can buy and get certification for. How you get there is by the one thing that I probably wouldn't change, is with retrospectives. So retrospectives are a way to get that feedback stuff that is really important to continuous improvement. You may need to change up the format to make something work for you, but really try and make sure that doesn't fall away. So in a nutshell, go find a good product owner that is empowered to make decisions. Keep your product management as simple as possible, and use retros to see if your processes are working for you. So, it's a bunch of different topics, all matched in one slide, one talk. So what I want to do is, I want to leave you with one slide that summarizes each of the sections that we've covered. So here I give you a rescue on the page. Empower your people and teams to unlock their potential. A lot of these organizations have lots of people, they're just really underutilized. Add security into your product delivery. Your security team is always going to be smaller than the rest of your delivery function. Work on how to amplify that so you can do things productively and securely. Leverage opinionated productive tech to get stuff done. Don't futz around doing, lots of technical stuff where it's like, this is cool, but I'm not solving any problems. Like, just get shit done. Be collaborative with your approach to architecture. We shouldn't have this ivory tower thought of our architecture team that actually just be another team that's working to do the same things that we're doing. And focus on delivering value with strong product management. So, for me, this is the key thing. Focus on delivering value. That's it. That's the only thing that matters. Everything else will kind of come out of launch. That's it. Thank you. We're hiring here. Thank you. Other than that, do you have any questions?
Can you go back to slide?
Yes. I'll leave that.
We're actually running about 10 or 15 minutes ahead of the other rooms, so you don't have to extend your question. And so, but yeah, if you do head out, just wait for those rooms to finish out. Let's go up to school, it's time to wait.
I got one, but I'm sure I have something.
Okay, well, I'll wait for you.
What tips would you give an agile team if they want to attract one of these strong, motivated, opinionated product owners? So if you have an agile team that's delivering software for the business, but your business users are incredibly high up, incredibly busy doing their ordinary jobs, how do you attract, how do you convince the organization that a full-time, highly motivated, highly involved product owner is a good thing to
have? I think a ninja. the simplest way I've seen do it is one of those things where you have to potentially do it a little bit particularly if you can't get the natural line of what you're asking for. I mean, you can say that, you know, getting a product owner will make all those things go away. But it's very different than actually having a product owner and watching those things go away. The simplest thing I've found to do is actually find someone who has a little bit of flex in the organization that really gives a shit about the product. They will evangelize it, they will help you with that sort of stuff. And then you've got something you can point to and in this case, a business case for how to do that. It may mean that you don't get a full-time product owner straight away, but it becomes an overactual thing. It's kind of the product of the organization. Anyone?
You mentioned just the governance function and architecture teams. I'm kind of curious about this because they're working themselves and not able to. People in that space, tech lead and development team downstream from that.
Yep.
What have you seen work in organisations where a lot of time and budget is consumed by architects who don't necessarily have great technical understanding prior to running their own projects?
Being a ninja. it's a similar thing. I found that in some cases, what you end up finding is there's a group of tech leads for different projects that will just start doing and actually do a familiar roundup. Then you basically just, then you have a group of people that have a counter-item to the things that currently being done. Unfortunately, that I can't give you a concrete answer because it depends on where the organization is, how much they're feeling the pain of all that investment. But generally, again, it comes down to just trying to do it some way. Sometimes you can find allies within the architecture team that are like, yeah, okay, this doesn't work, and we'll actually come along that journey with you, and then evangelize within their own teams. Eventually, it's got to be an organizational change to make these things really stick. But you can actually just start doing some of these things yourself anyway.
I just have a follow-up question as well. That was great. This is a particular interest, so I want to find out whether you've ever seen this, because you've seen a few different places. Have you ever seen a case where someone from the architecture function has successfully been seconded into the agile cross-functional team during the project delivery, and that's worked out?
Yeah, so I've seen that play out with other shared functions as well, like security. It can definitely be a good thing, because essentially, they get to empathise by seeing the pain that the team is facing there today. There needs to be a person that wants to be there and suddenly told to be there as well. It could definitely work.
Thanks. Okay. What kind of roles make good future product owners? Product owners, good ones, effective ones in the industry. Were they developers, designers, or BAs before that?
Sorry.
Sorry, my voice.
That's right, he's got my
From the most effective product owners in the industry, what kind of backgrounds do they have?
I've seen from a couple of different perspectives. I have seen really like BAs if you're onto that role, where they really become passionate about understanding what the product should do and what the users of that product they want. Kind of makes sense. In some cases, they've been analyzing that same product. The other time I've seen it is coming from the business side. So sometimes your SMEs will actually grow into that role, and that becomes the intersection of IT and the business, right? Ultimately, these companies are becoming tech companies, whether they like it or not. And so the more things we can do to foster that cross-pollination of those two things. So it doesn't really matter which side it comes from. As long as we really care about the product.
Question.
Yeah.
What kind of things can the teams do to help support the product owners?
Get behind the product owner. So the product owner is the one that has the vision, and they need to really get on board with that. One of the things that I found once I've had really good relationships with product owners, so like I go back to that paid sidekick, is calling out the limitations and the potential options. So you're going to run into walls all the time developing software. If you can basically call out, you know, why we can't do this particular thing, but we can do X, Y, Z instead, give them options for how they could actually still head towards the tree level where they're wanting to get, but actually potentially go by. Then potentially provide an alternative of how you think it could be a better.